I want to start by two apologies. First of all, my research field is very different than the one of most people here. And so what I'm talking about may be a bit obscure. I'll try to be clear. And the second one is that I'm going to present an argument that I've been presenting in the last 6 or 7 years. Some of you may have already heard it, so I apologize for that too. So here's the bottom line of my presentation. What I would like to argue is that, in fact, we don't hear our ears, and I take that as far as saying that music starts where the auditory system ends. So the goal of the auditory system is to create sound, the things, the perceptual things with which composers do music and listeners listen to music. All of that is done in the auditory system. It's the output of the auditory system. Everything else is done outside the auditory system. However, even though this is sounds are the output of the auditory system, the organization of sound is something that is represented very, very early. So I try to, one thing that I must make from the beginning, I mean, everything has to do with the physical stuff at the ears. It's not that I think I'm talking about any kind of extrasensory perception. And the big message of my talk is really the wide gap that exists between sensation. Here, what I mean by sensation is the measurement of the pressure waveform at the ear, right, that's the physical stuff, and perception, which is what we actually consciously perceive. Okay, so let's start at the beginning. We don't hear our ear. Okay, so here's the auditory system. Not the auditory system. Illustration of the auditory system. We start at the ear. And then there's a huge amount of stuff. Okay, that's the only thing that I want you to take out of this slide. Okay, there's a lot and a lot and a lot of stations. Up to here, okay, the anterior colliculus, we are actually in a very early part of the brain, which is called the brainstem. Okay, and then we go into the forebrain, the hypothalamus and cortex. Okay, so there's a huge amount of processing between the ears and anything that we would think about as responsible on conscious perception. And I want to concentrate a bit about what the ear does to sound. I want to tell you that the ear does something very bizarre to sound. The output of the ear is something that we don't have direct access to. So, again, you probably all heard that in the ear we have the auditory organ, the cochlea, this long tube that's coiled around itself. Okay, and again, you probably all heard that inside this tube there is a membrane that vibrates, that has different physical properties along its length, so that it tends to vibrate at high frequencies near its beginning and at low frequencies near its end because of various reasons. And then books on the auditory system, textbooks and so on, tell you roughly the following. If you have a low frequency sound, you will cause vibration mostly close to the far end of the tube. And if you have middle frequency one, it will be somewhere in the middle. And if it's high frequency, you will cause vibration close to the beginning of the tube. And since most sounds are complex sounds, you get peak of vibration at different locations that correspond to the different frequency components that are present in the sound. And usually the chapter ends by, and this is how we hear. Okay? Now, the point is that that's not an explanation of how we hear. What I want to show you is that this is exactly an explanation of how we don't hear. Again, we don't have a direct, it's true, I mean, we have this frequency decomposition, but we don't have much direct access to that decomposition. So to go forward, I need you to be able at least to sort of understand the spectrogram. So this is a plot this is a spectrogram of sound that played in a moment. Okay, the x-axis is time, y-axis is frequency. In that respect, it's like musical notation. Okay, the higher you are, the higher the frequency. So here, for example, you can see a sound that has high frequencies that go towards low frequencies. Also, the sound level goes from high to low. Okay, and then something. So this is how it sounds like. Okay. So you can probably relate what you heard to what you see here. Okay, that's fine. I can explain to you how it's done, but I'm going to skip that. Okay? So that was a spectrogram of a simple sound. Okay, now you all know now how to read a spectrogram, it's like musical notation. What's the sound that gave rise to that spectrogram? Okay. So I'm going to guide you slowly through this. First thing that I'm going to do is to emphasize the fact that the spectrogram is very strongly related to what the basilar membrane is doing, to what happened in the inner ear. Okay, so what I'm doing here is to show you a simulation of the basilar membrane. Okay, this is the beginning, that's close to the end, so here it will be sensitive to high frequencies and here to low frequencies. Okay, and I'm not going to present the sound, but you will see the vibration. Okay, so you can see how the membrane vibrates. Low frequency is here, high frequency is here. Okay, now what I'm going to do is to take the bit of sound that causes vibration here, at that location of the basilar membrane. I'm going to extract it out of the full sound and present it to you. Okay, so what I'm going to do is actually let you hear what the neurons that are sensitive to 2 kHz in this case, what these neurons are reporting to the rest of the brain. Okay, so basically what I did was to take the whole spectrogram and mask frequencies below and above 2 kHz, leave a narrow band here. Okay, and now you will hear. Okay, so this is what the neuron, the 2 kHz reported to the brain, and now I'm not going to do it very extensively, but try to reflect what the original sound was. Okay, someone said the vibrator, okay. So I will, to help you, I'm going to present for you a second bit of sound, okay, the sound around 600 Hz. Again, that's the bit of sound that neurons sensitive to 600 Hz report to the brain. It's the same sound, okay? These chirps at 2 kHz and this beat at 600 Hz are part of the same thing. Okay, what is it? And again, to help you still more, here's yet another beat of the sound at 300 Hz. Okay, so what's the point? The point is that what your brain gets from the ear are small bits like that. Okay, each neuron in the auditory nerve, in the early part of the auditory system, processes a little bit of sound like that. Okay, and now what was the whole sound? So here it is. Okay, so all of these three beats are all part of Kathleen Ferrier's singing bass. Okay, and the vibrator, okay, that's her vibrato. Okay, I will not go into the details of exactly the relationship between, I mean, that's the fundamental. You can see the small amount of vibrato here. On the harmonics, the vibrato becomes louder and louder because it's multiplied by the harmonic order and so on and so forth. You can see the long notes here, which are the notes that the viola plays, and down here are harmonics of the sound of the piano. Okay. Point is, again, that in the ear, the sound is shattered into small bits, none of which sounds like the final perceived version. Okay, now, there's a very good reason why this is so. I mean, whoever designed the auditory system did this type, produced this organ and made it do this frequency analysis for good reasons. Okay, but we don't hear it. Okay, what we hear is the result of taking all of these small bits and combining them together into something that has the perceptual qualities. In fact, we don't have a good semantics to describe what's going on here. Okay? When we say sound, we usually imply the thing that we perceive. So you're going to talk about the sound of my voice, but the thing that arrived to your ears is maybe very different. It includes the sound of my voice, but also all the sounds from around. All of that together is a big mishmash that arrives to your ears, and somehow your brain extracts my voice out of it. Okay, so let's go to the second claim. My claim is that sounds are generated and are the output of the auditory system. So let's start again by this scheme. We know very well what happened in the low part, earlier part of the auditory system, from the cochlea to the first central station. Okay, we call that low-level audition. It has to do with the physical structure of sounds. If the electrical activity in this part of the brain represents anything, it represents the vibration of the basilar membrane. Okay, not the perceived sound. Okay, it describes very well the physical structure of whatever arrives to your ears. We have good models for that, and as I showed you, we don't have direct conscious access to these representations. Now, at the other half, at the other side of the auditory system, we have high-level audition, perceptual qualities of sound. We can talk about pitch and timbre, and loudness, and all kinds of things like that, maybe context predictions, all kinds of... All of that has to do with the perceptual qualities. You hear a chord of piano and you are being asked for two melodies that happen at the same time, two notes that are playing at the same time, it's your brain that separates between them. It's not, there are not, the separation between them is not represented early in the auditory system. So we have good, good conscious access, but very poor models to what happens. And I want again to emphasize that we hear a huge amount of details out of the sound. So again, this is yet another example. Here's the waveform, that spectrogram. Anyone can guess what the sound is? Okay, very hard. Here it is. Okay, so now I can ask you questions like, what did you hear? People laughing. How many? Between 1 and 10. Men, women? Probably both. Okay, all of that is something that you got out of this mix. Okay, so you don't, they're not present here. Okay. There is something that has been derived from that. Again, no ESP, okay, no magic principle. Okay. We hear what happened in the ear. But there's a huge amount of processing that happens here, and perception is very far from the physical representation of these sounds. Okay. So we have this huge in between, okay, between the low level representations and the low level representation. And these high-level areas of the brain where the perception already occurred and you manipulate the perceived elements. Okay, that's a field that we tend, some of us at least, tend to call mid-level audition. It suffers both from having poor models and being largely inaccessible. That's a transformation from physics to perception. Okay, and in a sense, this what lies between the high-level concept that you would like to explain when you talk about music and the low-level concept that we talk about, or the brain type of concept that we talk about when we talk about the processing of sound of the brain. So we have this intermediate area that has been studied now from the 1970s or so very explicitly. And we know, okay, that these low level, at the end, okay, these low level stuff produce this high level stuff. Okay, at least we, the biologists, believe that this is what happened. And we have to take into account again the no magic principle. So over the years, we came up with weeds, the royal weed, okay, people that have been in the field. Came up with a large number of mechanisms that take this mishmash, that occurs at the early part of the auditory system and end up with these perceptual objects. Okay, and again, the main point of what I want to make here is that this is a hard and complicated process. It's, in a sense, generative. Okay, you start with information from the ears and you end up with something. Okay, and that's what the auditory system does. Okay, this is the main difficult task of the auditory system. Okay. Having said that, again, there are things that are related to music that are represented very early in the auditory system. Even before sounds are fully represented, organization of sound is already reflected in the sensory responses. Okay, so that's the last thing that I want to show. Okay, basically, how do I know that organization is reflected in neural activity? The standard way is to present a sequence of sounds or a sound, create some expectation, and then to violate them. And if there's electricity that's coming out of the head that I can measure, okay, I can conclude that there was a representation of the organization that allowed me to make a prediction. There's a whole lot of surprise responses in the brain. Here's one of the most famous one. It's cognitive negativity. Okay, so this is a slide that I stole from Leon de Uel about 10 years ago. This is Leon. And what you do is to present a sequence of sounds. One of them happens a lot, the other one is rare. Okay, and if you average separately the electricity coming out of the brain to the common and rare sound, okay, you find out that the rare sound evoke a more negative response than the common sound. So by subtracting the response to the common sound from the response to the rare sound, you're left with this negativity, which is called mismatch negativity. Now, mismatch negativity occurs about 100 milliseconds after the first auditory responses in auditory cortex. So it's relatively, as far as we are concerned, that's a relatively late response. And there's quite a lot of mismatch negativity is only one out of a whole list of, I'm not going to go over it, of components that occur later and later and represent higher and higher types of organization in the brain. Let me skip this. Okay, and the question that we asked at some point about 15 years ago is whether we can observe similar phenomena at the level of single neurons. Okay, so many students over a number of generations of PhD students and postdocs in my lab worked on these issues, and I will show you just two simple results. So first of all, we are now talking not about perception and not about EEG recorded from the scalp, but we are talking about actual responses of actual neurons. So this is just an illustration. There's an electrode here. Okay, this is the so-called cell body of the neuron. The electrode is inside, and you see here the electricity. So you have memory potential and these very short events that are called spikes. Okay, these are the output signals of the neuron. So this is a recording done in my lab. Okay, the membrane potential with spikes recorded from a neuron in the brain of the rat. The rat was anesthetized. The neuron is in auditory cortex. Okay, if I just magnify a bit, you can see here the fluctuation of the membrane potential, and from time to time there's a spike riding on top of the membrane potential. Okay, so what we did in the first example I'm going to show you are just responses to oddball sequences. So these are sequences of the type that Leon was doing on his slide. Okay, and you see here a bit of the membrane potential recorded from one neuron. Okay, so this is a common sound, a rare sound, and another common sound. You see that this common sound didn't do anything to the membrane potential. That red sound now evoked a spike. Okay, and this one also evoked a spike, actually. Okay. So we can compare responses to the red sound, to the common sound just before the red sound with the responses to the following red sound. Okay, so here you see many repetition of this measurement. And you can see here that whereas the membrane potential didn't do anything special when the common sound was presented, it did evoke a very specific response pattern on many of the representations. of the harmonic presentation of the rare sound. Okay, so neurons, we call this stimulus-specific adaptation. Okay, and the point is that this effect, the fact that neurons respond to a rare sound more strongly than to a common sound, is something that occurs very early in the auditory system. It occurs already in the brainstem, okay, far earlier than the auditory cortex. Now, we have the reason to believe that the representation of these surprises is stronger or more sophisticated in auditory cortex, but it starts as early as the brainstem. Okay, so I will show you just one more bit before I conclude. I will show you that these responses are actually sensitive to things that are more refined than just probability of sound. What we did was to present either a random sequence of common and rare sounds, like that one, or a periodic sequence that has the same probability of the common and rare sound. Okay, so here the rare sounds occur with a probability of 25%, one every four sounds, here two. Okay, but here they occur exactly in every fourth position. Okay, so this is a periodic sequence, okay, and that one is a random sequence. Okay, so we presented such sequences, okay, and we recorded the responses, and here I show you responses to two sounds that have been used as standards, common and rare. Okay, so these are the response to that sound when common. Okay, so the blue is the response to that sound when common in the random sequence, and the green is the response to the same sound when common in the periodic sequence. Okay, so the brain of this anesthetized rat was sensitive even to this difference. Okay, it knows when the sequence is periodic and when it's not. And one important feature for us, at least, is that the probability of the rare sound in this case was 1 over 20. So the rare sound occurred every 20th sound on average. In the random sequence and exactly in the periodic one. Okay, so I will conclude. What can we conclude about this in relationship to music? Okay. So I want to just to quote Gab Barrez about music being organized sound, and to the extent that music is organized sound, okay, this is the conclusion. Organization occurs before sounds are represented. Okay, and with this, thank you.